Ames is a weird story. In 2001, the company filed for bankruptcy, officially closing all of its stores by mid-2002. The 50s-based retail mega-company that so many grew up with was finally gone, after decades of successful trudging through the market. But why? Why did Ames go out of business so early? Well, that's what we're going to be looking at on this week's episode, so sit back, relax, and let's dive into the story of Ames.
If you believe in saving on your favorite names, see for yourself, you can believe in
Save at Ames on all your holiday shopping, like this 19-inch Emerson color TV for only $199.99. Save on huggable, lovable pound puppies by Tonka, now only $14.88. Cutest dogs on 4 feet. Find what you're looking for after Thanksgiving at Ames because
you can believe in Ames.
Ames was founded in 1958 by two Connecticut-based brothers, Milton and Irving Gilman. The original Ames store started in an old mill warehouse in rural Massachusetts, with the name for the store simply being the name of the textile company that once owned the warehouse. The main goal behind Ames was to open the retail market to rural areas that were isolated from the rest of society. This served them rather well as time moved on, as by 1971, the old Ames Mill store was replaced by a newer location in Sturbridge, and just a few years short of a decade later, another store was opened up all the way in Vermont. Throughout its history, Ames stayed primarily a Northeastern region store. It focused its markets on small towns and rural areas, opening up locations in small towns and plazas. In early 72, Ames purchased the K&R Warehouse and Joseph Leavitt Corporations, which I could not find any information on, unfortunately. That same year, they also entered the NYSE. In the late 70s, Ames acquired the Davis Wholesale Company, which earned them around 30 new retail locations. Not even a year later, Ames also purchased the Niesner Brothers, earning them 32 stores both in New York and, strangely, Florida. Ames by this point had 47 store locations. Even though they would go on to close 10 New York Ames locations, the company was still doing incredibly well. Purchasing dying brands and converting them to a new Ames location provided cheap real estate for the company. Through 1981, Ames had 115 stores throughout the Northeast, with 20 discount variety stores in the South. In 1984, Ames purchased the King's department store chain, gaining its 193 store locations. Only a year later, they also purchased the Pennsylvania-based chain, the J.C. Murphy Corporation, a variety and retail store chain. Ames at this point was unbeatable. The company's higher-ups controlled the finances of the brand incredibly tightly, allowing Ames to not only continue to sell quality goods at low prices for their market, but to also make a large profit while doing so. By 1981, Ames had sales of around $400 million, a huge portion of which were gained during the Christmas season in the final financial quarter of the year. However, this is when things began to go wrong. Ames had gone on for such a long streak of buying and converting old brands that they decided to take a large risk in 1988 and purchase Zehrs, the topic of next week's episode, by the way. Zehrs was both a large and expensive brand with an incredibly rich history. It was an $800 million sale. Ames not only doubled its stores, however, after this purchase, but also became the third largest US discount retailer. They acquired 392 different locations across the East and Midwest. This led to budgeting issues that kept getting worse and worse as time went on, until the early 90s when Ames would eventually go bankrupt. Ames had begun to make cuts to their budget in order to make up for unprofitable Zehrs locations. In early 1989, 74 Zehrs stores were closed, alongside 3 Ames stores. Ames also began selling off their brands that they had acquired over time, like G.C. Murphy. They began to shift their focus more to their discount retailing. Ames kept up the branding of the old Zehrs stores and reopened over 250 old Zehrs locations rebranded as Ames ones, renovating and updating each store. As a result of Zehrs being purchased by Ames, Zehrs offices were reduced in number and many of the Zehrs management was laid off. As time continued forwards, their profits did the opposite. They began seeing losses in 89 as the economy in the Northeast began to slow as well. The rest of the year wasn't any better. By the end of 1989, Ames had lost a total of $28 million. Even though Ames had kept up the Zehrs brand name, they eliminated many aspects of Zehrs, like their deep discount and 24-hour store days, making it sell lower-priced versions of traditional Zehrs products. This all led to lower sales over time, as customers that would once shop at Zehrs stopped coming as often. Add to it, Ames eliminated the Zehrs credit card and swapped it out for standard Visa cards. In the early year of 1990, Ames closed down even more traditional Zehrs stores. This all manifested until mid-1990, when Ames finally filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. It was over for Ames. Or so it seemed. That same year, Ames began to slowly dig itself out of the bankruptcy caused by their acquisition of Zehrs. Ames managed to get $250 million worth of loan money from a bank in New York. Ames first started recovering by closing down a third of its stores, firing over 18,000 people. They also began to liquidate their most failing stores in the South and Midwest, gaining hundreds of millions from it. However, there were still excessive losses. In October of that year, they closed 77 more stores as a result. In 92, Ames closed down over 60 more locations in order to pay off their New York creditors. The rest of 1992 was characterized by large issues and slow profits. Ames attempted to lure customers into stores with big discounts on certain items, only, to their shock, to realize that people were only buying the discounted goods, costing them tens of millions in losses by late 1992. Then, as if by miracle, in early 1993, Ames exited Chapter 11 bankruptcy. This seemed too good to be true. And it was. Ames would go on to make the same mistake and finally shutter its doors in the early 2000s.
You can miss the royal wedding, but you can't miss the Ames One Day Sale Thursday only. Save 25 to 50% off all clothing and accessories for men, women, and kids. 30% off all furniture and lighting. You can miss the moon landing, but not 30% off all gas grills, patio furniture, fans, and air conditioners. Plus 20 to 40% off all sheets, towels, curtains, and draperies. You can miss the inauguration, but not 60% off all fine jewelry. Plus, take another 30% off your fine jewelry purchase at the register. The Ames One Day Sale Thursday only. You can't miss.
You have reached the Nostalgia Hotline. A representative will be with you shortly. We thank you for your patience.
Ames now only operated around 310 stores overall. In 1993, Ames named a new chairman, Paul Buxbaum, with Joseph Ettore, the former CEO of James Way Corp, becoming company CEO in 1994. That same year, Ames finally began to make positive net gain again. In 1994, Ames introduced a discount program for senior shoppers called the 55 Gold Program. This ended up paying off as it aided in traffic and thus revenue. However, as well as Ames was doing, competition was as well. Walmart and Target had begun to expand into the Northeast retail market, which began serving as an issue for Ames. As a response to the new competition, Ames began to modernize and renovate their locations. In 1996, Ames saw both issues and positives. They opened 12 new Ames locations from their former Bradley stores, a discount department store chain I should also make a video on sometime. They also managed to get hold of multiple Caldor and Montgomery Ward store locations after the companies then began to liquidate. However, in 1996, Ames struggled with their holiday season, leading them to close another 17 store locations and get hit with $20 million worth in charges. In 1997, they essentially went silent. However, by 1998, Ames had a strong year ahead of them. They decided, like they did back in 88, to take another risk, and in that same year, Ames purchased the Hills department store chain for $330 million, giving them over 100 new stores and putting them behind Walmart, Target, and Kmart. Ames now had more locations in New York, in the Midwest, and even the South. In 1999, Ames refurbished and converted the old Hills stores, and later that year, also purchased the Caldor Corporation, as well as a massive distribution center in Massachusetts. I brought up the Caldor earlier, so I'm just restating it now. However, just like they went up quickly, they also went down quickly. In 1999, Ames closed 8 store locations. In 2000, they were successful in acquiring the Goldblatt department store chain, as well as Venture and Builders Square. However, that same year, they closed 32 store locations, 31 of which were from Hills. In mid-2001, they closed 16 more stores and their massive distribution center. Later that year, Ames closed 54 stores, and in mid-2002, they closed another 6 stores as well. They had replicated the same ambitious mistake that they had made in the early 90s with Zehrs, but it didn't get better this time, as on August 14, 2002, Ames announced that the remaining 327 store sites would close down, this time filing for Chapter 7 bankruptcy liquidation. The Hills buy had destroyed them. However, it wasn't just Hills. Walmart, as always, began entering into the Northeast retail market, taking it by storm, as always. That had put Ames in a bad competitive spot. Not to mention Ames was still trailing behind companies like Kmart and Target in size. When Ames began to die out, Target took advantage as well and entered the Northeastern market. However, it didn't matter what they tried to do after that. By mid-2002, Ames was officially gone. There are no more Ames stores left open today. All are abandoned, left sitting to rot in discount plazas.
Shop Ames Wrap Up Christmas Sale now. There's still good selections for all your gift needs. Entire stock of Junior and Mrs. outerwear reduced 25%. Many styles and colors to choose from. And great gifts for all the men on your list. Our entire stock of men's active separates, jackets, and pants reduced 25%. Wrap up Christmas with big, big savings. All Ames stores open late every night.
Ames had a very strange retail history. A company started out with an old textile mill that grew to dominate the Northeast in just a few decades. It also tells a story of ambition, too much ambition. Ames had grown so large due to their business model that year by year, they kept taking it to another level until they decided to make their biggest purchase by that time, Zehrs. Zehrs destroyed them. And when they were able to recover from it, they did the same exact mistake again. Hills was like a modern-day Zehrs to Ames, an ambitious buy that wasn't necessary and did much more harm than good. Coupled with overbearing competition, Ames was inevitably a recipe for disaster. They were modern for the time, had good products and decent prices. As much as it was flawed, their business model was still really good. However, they flew too close to the sun, and that led them to fall from grace.